morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
It's a soul-fulfilling, deeply satisfying kind of time, but it does come with a little sadness, because it'll soon be over. It's just been a wonderful fall roundup this year. Horses are in great shape, cattle are looking good, and the calves are fat and bringing pretty darn decent prices too. And this kind of sentimentality, I guess, really is beautifully expressed in a song by my friend Duke Davis that you will hear a little later in the show. And now, back in the 70s, a $500 truck was hauling a $2,500 rope horse around. That's not much money for a horse these days, but a whopping amount back then. The horse's name was Junior, and he was owned by the legendary J.W. Bear Man Campbell. And I'm going to pull out a clip from the vault featuring Bear Man and Junior.
Wow, are we carrying the mail? And we come down past the grandstand. He says, whatever you people think, this is not the first race of the evening. And he said, I think that JW is out of control, he said.
And those were the words of a legendary rodeo announcer, and you'll hear who he was when we get to that story from the vault. Now, is the environment of our beef cattle industry really beginning a seismic shift? Well, you'll find out on the Rangeland News.
Are beef cattle producers beginning to hold back some heifers for breeding or not?
Oh, yes, and we will also have the results of the Skills of the Outfit West of the Rockies competition for you. And on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file, I'll describe everything that I think a good ranch horse should be capable of doing. Now, I recently got the news that a legend of the area around North Central British Columbia and drove his team and wagon and logging rigging across the Great Divide. It seems like a long time ago that we got a call from Harry Prosser asking if I could bring Lucky, my buckskin mare, and Billy to Tumbler Ridge for their 25th anniversary celebration and open the show for the RCMP musical ride. Well, we did, and it was an unforgettable time, and I did manage to squeeze in an interview with Harry.
50 logs, 50 to 60, 70 logs in that area usually, and most make up a truckload, and a man and a team can put out that much in a day. I did, I'll be 70 next April, and I did put out several days last winter, I put out a truckload of logs.
In the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, ranch wife Yvonne Hollenbach has a good one about sorting day from the ranch wife perspective. And that redneck, blue-collar, pure music of the land guy, Tim Huss, gets it all going.
There's an 18-point elk rack hanging above the door. The boot heels of the dancers have worn grooves upon the floor. The cowboys have been drinking here since the Prohibition days. Old booms and drought years pass through the place. There's a hitching rail out in front and another on the side. A long bar with a brass rail, bottles of rye. The barmaid's name is Katie, and they say she's 80 proof. With a Chinook arch in the west, the water pouring off the roof. Ian Tyson is singing Navajo Rug. Ranchers in the corner are dealing five-card stud. Coyotes are howling underneath the moon. Here at the hotel saloon. Just past the grain elevator across the railroad tracks. Right next door to the Western store. Saddle and tack. The sign out front says home-cooked meals. Rooms upstairs. Something else no one can read, but nobody seems to care. The rig crew stop from time to time. Everybody's welcome here. There's hot coffee and buffalo steaks and bottles of beer. There's a cowboy band on the weekend and all of the hockey games. You could spend the night or spend your life and feel it just the same. Ian Tyson is singing Navajo Rug. Ranchers in the corner are dealing five-card stud. Coyotes are howling underneath the moon. Here at the hotel saloon. They still play Wilf Carter here on the worn-out jukebox. Two-step or a shuffle or a Rocky Mountain waltz. There's horseshoes by the fireplace on the wall with the wagon wheel. When the mercury starts falling, it warms against the chill. There's a cow horse at the rail, hitched up side by side, with a panel truck, a horse trailer, and the snowmobiles in line. And it really does get busy here once the sun goes down. You ought to see it on the long weekend when the rodeo's in town. Ian Tyson is singing Navajo Rug. Ranchers in the corner are dealing five-card stud. Coyotes are howling underneath the moon. Here at the hotel saloon. Ian Tyson is singing Navajo Rug. Ranchers in the corner are dealing five-card stud. Coyotes are howling underneath the moon. Here at the hotel saloon.
Well, it was 2006 when we took that memorable trip to Tumbler Ridge with Lucky the Wonder Horse, and we still have that stall sign they gave us with her name on it. Hangs right above the door to her box stall, and the certificate that says Lucky, lifetime member of the Grizzly Valley Saddle Club, we still have that as well. Now, in September of that year, here's what you'd have heard on this program.
Well, is it possible in this day and age to live a dream? When I was working in other industries, trucking and broadcasting, I dreamed of living and working with good horses, and I am so blessed now to be able to do that just about every day. And Harry Prosser has been able to make the dream come true. He's my guest this week, and Harry, how did it happen for you?
Well, 13 years ago, approximately, I decided that I had enough of just doing the going out working for a wage, and I had a dream that if I could make a living with a team of horses, I'd be living my dream, and that's just exactly what I'm doing.
How did it start? Did you have horses, or did you have to find a team that would work?
I've had riding horses. I was born and brought up on a farm in Ontario, and we used horses. That's what we used. We had nothing out. We had no tractors. We're talking about back in the late 30s and the 40s, in particular. And so I was quite used to horses. But yes, I had to go out and buy a team and just say, hey, and then I got a lot of help from a lot of people, and away we went.
Harry's good horses one time saved his legs and possibly his life when something went wrong a while back. He'll have the story when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Oh, the beautiful Caribbean. Famous for turquoise water, sailing, snorkeling, and hanging out on the beach with endless sunshine. That's where you could be enjoying the camaraderie of folks you'll have a lot in common with. The 2025 Spirit of the West cruise aboard the Majestic Princess, and you will see 8 of the Caribbean's most beautiful ports of call. Airfare is included. This is a 14-day Circle of Caribbean cruise, and for details, just call toll-free 1-800-530-0131. The 2025 cruise destination visits 9 fantastic ports of call, sailing round trip from Fort Lauderdale.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. A lot of cattle, a lot of cowboys made that long trek from Texas to Montana. Some of them never made it back to Texas, and Ken Overcast, the great singer and rancher from Chinook, can look to some of his ancestors who did just that, and he put the story into a song that's coming right up. Harry Prosser is a horse logger, and that's a rewarding but dangerous job that usually takes someone young and wiry and strong. Harry's strong, all right, but he's not as young as some of the folks doing the job might be. And Harry, as we know, horse logging can be dangerous.
Well, yes, it sometimes gets a little scary, and you definitely want to know your horses, and don't take a horse to the bush that's not got the right mindset is the biggest thing that I find.
Do you ever have any close calls? Tell us about it.
Yes, I have. One time in particular, I was doing something I shouldn't have been doing. I was logging by myself with no partner. I knew that he was gone for a little while, and I should have stopped. And I got my leg under a log, and it wasn't hurting me, but I couldn't move. And I had to depend on those horses to stand where they were, and I had to wait for about an hour and a half, till my friend come back. And he come over, took a look at me, said, "What are you doing there?" But then he had just had to take the horses, which I couldn't do. I only had one line, and the wrong one, and turn the opposite way and get out. But I just had to wait.
Boy, and that team just stood there. If they'd have taken off.
Well, if they'd have taken off, they'd have taken my leg with it because it was underneath the root.
There's more from Harry in a couple of minutes. My pal Rick Huff describes Ken Overcast as the cowboy singer with a grin like a Cadillac grill. Man, that is a nice set of teeth. Now, Ken and Don run a fine cattle operation just out of Chinook, Montana, and on his latest CD, Ken has included a song about the early cattle drives from Texas. And this song was inspired by his great uncle who landed in Montana in the 1870s. An old Indian man offered Ken's uncle one of his daughters for the horse he was riding.
Just 6 months ago, south of San Angelo, Captain Teddy Blue put me on. Seems like 100 years I've been following these steers. It's too far back and I'm not gonna go. I'm too long gone. It's too far back to Texas and my old Lone Star home. You boys ride on ahead, Montana's my new home. She's too far back to Texas and I'm too long gone. A spell here beside the mussel shell, and where I'll settle down is hard to say. And I think I'll take the trade for that young Lakota maid her daddy offered me for my bay. I'm too long gone. It's too far back to Texas and my old Lone Star home. You boys ride on ahead, Montana's my new home. It's too far back to Texas, and I'm too long gone. Far back to Texas and my old Lone Star home. You boys ride on ahead, Montana's my new home. It's too far back to Texas and I'm too long gone. She's too far back to Texas and I'm too long gone.
Well, a good teamster, good team of horses, and you know it's amazing just how much timber you can haul out in a day. And Harry Prosser is a horse logger. Harry, just how much work can you get done in a what you'd call a good day in the bush?
50 logs, 50 to 60, 70 logs in that area usually, and most make up a truckload, and a man and a team can put out that much in a day. I did, I'll be 70 next April, and I did put out several days last winter, I put out a truckload of logs.
My gosh. And so summer and winter, year round?
This summer I haven't done very much, normally I've been working some in the summertime, not when it's real hot, and all winter long.
I see my horse just discovered the pig. She just noticed him. She's coming to life back there. Billy's there with her. So. And what about good? Have you had the same team all the time, or have you changed them?
No. I've had two good teams. The one I've got now, and another one that I've got from the Pattersons in Dawson Creek, who are well known in the stock industry, and Art Patterson has been my mentor for years. And I got the Bruce Patterson team. It was the first ones I had, so they were well looked after before I got them, and they served me well.
And I could see that you sure enjoyed taking all the folks around on the wagon rides today. And, you know, you got this nice wagon, reins in your hand, and this nice full white beard. Has anybody ever given you offers around Christmas time to play Santa?
Oh, actually, quite a few times.
I think I saw you in a movie or two or something.
I will say I was at the original Quintet Mine parties, the first 3 years, I was the first Santa Claus in Tumbler Ridge.
Is that right?
When the people arrived.
Well, he sure looked the part. As I mentioned, Harry Prosser left us earlier this year, and that was from a great visit we had up in Tumbler Ridge quite some time ago. Now, coming up is an amazing story from the vault, featuring the legendary calf roper J.W. Bear Man Campbell and his famous rope horse, Junior, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
It was 1967. Jim Bear Man Campbell bought a big sorrel gelding from world champion roper Junior Garrison for $2,500 and immediately named the horse Junior. And he knew right from the start that he had bought something special. He just didn't know how the big sorrel gelding was going to be one of those once-in-a-lifetime special horses. For the next 12 years or so, Bear Man hauled Junior to rodeos in Canada and the U.S. and mounted a lot of the world's top cowboys on him. Guys like Phil Lynn, Jeff Copenhaver, Bob Ragsdale, Paul Tierney, and Roy Cooper. That's just to name a few. And paid many mount money checks to Jim over the years. Now, Kenny McLean rode Junior when he won the Canadian Championship in 1972, and he also won the Calgary Stampede the same year, riding Junior. And the next year, 1973, Tom Ferguson won the calf roping at Calgary, riding Junior. And I met Bear Man at the Ivan Danes Country Music Picnic a few years ago, and here's one of the stories he told us.
Great to have you here, JW. Now, what's this story that I've heard rumors about here and there, about some kind of a race that you had that saw you on your horse with no saddle and no bridle and just causing havoc in a rodeo arena a few years back? What happened there?
We're at Pale Porcelain, and Stan Hart and me, and there's a whole bunch of Sparky Trotter and Kenny. It's a 10-day rodeo, and it rained every day just about. So we'd spend half the day driving our blankets and stuff out, and it got about the 8th perf or so that Stan and I started riding bareback, you know, like we just a pad over, you know, with bridle, and because half the grand entry would go out the south end and come around to the right and half to the left and pledge the flag, and Cy Tilton was the rodeo announcer.
Cy Tilton?
Yeah.
Oh, man, I remember him.
Yeah, he's one of the greats. And
classy guy.
Oh, lordy. So it was the very last day, and I was getting more and more fed up with being wet all the time. So I took and I just rode him plumb bareback. And Stan, he had bridle on and a pad, but I was just riding just bareback as could be. with a hauler, and I just took the hauler through the, like the rope through the hauler, the shank through the hauler, and in the mouth, and kind of like a little Indian war battle, but, and that's all good. And Sparky, he had a real nice gray quarter horse, and I had this red horse, and he was always kind of wanting to race me, but, and I'd always restrained from that. But the last day, I thought, what the hell, and I slid that rope ahead, and well, I'll tell you what, he spit that rope out of his mouth, and wow, are we carrying the mail? And we come down past the grandstand. They cleared a path for me. Everybody else under control, but I wasn't. He says, whatever you people think, this is not the first race of the evening. And he said, I think that JW is out of control, he said. And I go around, and I come back. I make another trip, just boom, and my hat's bent right back as I go by. And when I come around the next time, when I was going around the second time, there was a Budweiser team coming off the backstretch, and I thought, well, I got just barely enough room to get around the back of that sucker. And just then, two of these long-haired hippies back in the 70s, and I went right between them, just whoof, knocked one on each leg just flat right into the mud. And I come around there, and that old horse just come up to the tie rack and just stopped, and big blow, and says, you know what, I've been wanting to run for the last 9 days. And he said, I just done it. So I crawl, I walk back there, check my victims. They're both standing up, and I thought, that's good.
From a radiator cap to an engine block, BZTractorParts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal Deutz Leyland, Landini, Oliver Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com. Just ahead of the news from the rangeland, I downloaded a brand new album from Robert Bean, and boy, it's full of real puncher stuff, good authentic cowboy songs like this one.
He clocks in each morning and opens his toolbox to the pictures taped to the lid from an old magazine. They serve to remind him of places he loved as a kid. One of a cowboy dragging an old steer up to a hot branding iron. Another of friends gathered up in the evening, swapping tales around a warm cooking fire. Mind, he's riding up high in the mountains, down in the valley below, getting lost in the dreams that he'd like to find in the pictures he paints in his mind. She works in an office surrounded by windows 25 floors from the ground, caught up in the rat race of the 9-to-5 world. She dreams of the sweet prairie sound. She longs for the feel of soft saddle leather that her chair just can't provide. In the painting carries her away as across the wide prairie she rides. In her mind she's riding up high in the mountains, down in the valley below, getting lost in the dreams that she'd like to find. She paints her mind. We get lost in the pictures we hang on the walls of the places we hold in our hearts, and we live out our lives in daydream pieces, forgetting that life is an art. Through the coulees and draws of our minds, we go riding to the places that we wish to be. And the real world around us completely surrounds us with the day-to-day lives that we lead. Minds, we're riding up high in the mountains, down in the valley below, and lost in the dreams that we'd like to find in the pictures we paint in our minds. We get lost in the dreams that we'd like to find in the pictures we paint in our minds.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West, a roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says it's really hard these days to get timely answers to a lot of questions. For example,
are beef cattle producers beginning to hold back some heifers for breeding or not? Are we still in contraction mode? Friday's USDA Cattle on Feed report offers hardly any clue to that. USDA livestock analyst Shale Shagham says we will probably have to wait a month for the next real clue.
When we get the October 1st inventory number, it will provide us with a breakout of the sex of the animals on feed. So that could provide us with a little indication about whether or not, you know, we're seeing higher proportions of heifers being put on feed, you know, which could give us a little bit of an indication about the retention of heifers for addition to the breeding herd.
Meanwhile, Friday's Cattle on Feed report shows August placements into feedlots 1% below a year ago, and the September 1st feedlot inventory up 1%. Gary Crawford reporting for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Well, thank you, Gary Crawford. I'm not sure if we learned anything there, but it was interesting. Now, the USDA's Economic Research Service reports a historic rise in beef prices, with the national average exceeding $8 a pound. This increase, however, is not translated into sustainable profits for cattle ranchers, who are, of course, squeezed by various market forces. And according to Elijah Griles from the Virginia Farm Bureau Federation, the cost of raising cattle is climbing, particularly for feeder cattle, because of the increased interest rates and input costs. Drought conditions in many areas are compounding these challenges, leading to a scarcity of essential resources like hay. And the ongoing reduction in cattle numbers driven by ranchers opting to sell female cattle rather than retain them is leading to a smaller future stock. The strategy, while a short-term necessity, may lead to longer-term issues in maintaining supply levels, especially with an anticipated drop in beef demand in 2025. Norway has reported dozens of confirmed and suspected cases of blue tongue. That's an insect-borne virus that is harmless to humans, but it can be fatal to livestock. And this is the first time the country's had it since 2009. The Norwegian Veterinary Institute says the virus known as blue tongue stereotype 3, or BTV-3, was first detected in livestock in southern Norway on the 6th of September. And the disease is spread by midges and ticks that are typically found in warmer climates. An environmental group is suing U.S.-based meat processor Tyson Foods for allegedly misleading consumers by saying it will reach net zero emissions by 2050 and marketing climate-friendly beef without meaningful plans to achieve these goals. These types of greenwashing claims are on the rise, and consumers have a right to know the truth about their food choices. The words of Carrie Apfel, an attorney with Earth Justice, on a press call. Earth Justice is representing EWG in the suit, along with the Animal Legal Defense Fund, Edelson PC, and Farm Stand. Maple Leaf Foods says legal claims brought by Canada Bread in relation to an ongoing investigation into allegations of bread price fixing are manufactured and without merit. Maple Leaf Foods has done nothing wrong here, the company said in an interview in September. Earlier this month, Canada Bread alleged that Maple Leaf Foods personnel directed and participated in certain anti-competitive conduct. Well, see how that one goes. Now, the Skills of the Outfit West of the Rockies was an event full of cowboys and cowgirls in flat brim hats, high top boots, and a variety of buckaroo gear. And these are the results of the competition. In the youth division, first place went to Shelley Campbell on Chai. And in the novice division, it was Nicole Ulrich on Maximus Del Bozo. What a horse he was. The intermediate division winner was David Siriani on Scoot. And in the big guy, the big boys and gals division, the open division, the winner was Kurt Martintail on Levi. And the top hand award went to Josh Friesen on Ray. I sure had fun doing the commentary and visiting with everybody, and you can get more results at CanadianBridleHorse.com. There is a regular sale and a special calf sale with Angus Influence at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op on October 15th, and then the Williams Lake regular sale on the 16th. No, that's the calf sale on the 16th, the regular sale on the 17th at Williams Lake, and regular sale in Vanderhoof on the 18th of October. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, pre-calf sales on October 21st and 28th and November the 4th. Calves are received Sundays and sorted in groups and sold on Mondays. Then, of course, regular cattle sales every Wednesday. Just call Dwayne, Mark, or Danny at 1-800-710-3166 or see InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. And now the final item. I was thinking about Fred Feistman the other day and how a friend of mine could use his services. You see, Fred's one of the good hands that I heal calves with at some brandings in the area. And in fact, when we branded our calves here last spring, Fred was the only roper because they were our calves and I had to work on the ground. And he has a great track record as a wealth management expert. Anyhow, this guy I know should have called Fred before he sold his ranch and tried to manage the money himself. When the ranch sold, he put half the money in a big company that makes paper towels, and the other half of the money in a big outfit that sells revolving doors, and the poor guy was wiped out before he could turn around. And that's the Rangeland News. Coming up, the horse training file outlines the characteristics of a well-broke working ranch horse. All the things a horse of that description should be capable of doing when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. It sure makes me grin when we're preg testing, weaning, sorting, or other work like that when somebody says, boy, that horse of yours sure works nice. Opening gates, sorting pairs, separating yearling steers from yearling heifers, and she seems to even know the difference. All part of ranch horse's resume, and I will elaborate on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file coming right up. And so is winter, and with winter just around the corner, frigid temperatures, snow and ice, how does this sound? Oh, the beautiful Caribbean. Famous for turquoise water, sailing, snorkeling, and hanging out on the beach with endless sunshine. That's where you could be enjoying the camaraderie of folks you'll have a lot in common with. The 2025 Spirit of the West cruise aboard the Majestic Princess, and you will see 8 of the Caribbean's most beautiful ports of call. Airfare is included. This is a 14-day Circle of Caribbean cruise. And for details, just call toll-free 1-800-530-0131. The 2025 cruise destination visits 9 fantastic ports of call, sailing round trip from Fort Lauderdale. And this is pretty important to us. Every cabin we fill on our cruise helps us keep this program on the air. And thanks to all of you who've already booked.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Whether you're in the pasture or the oil patch, you work hard. And you need quality workwear that's up to the challenge. Look no further than Irvine Tack and Western Wear. They've got it all to keep you warm and safe, including fire-resistant and high-visibility clothing. Featuring the biggest names in workwear from Ariat, Byrne, and Wrangler. Stop in or shop online at irvins.ca, exit 305, off Highway 2 by Crossfield.
The world's greatest Western store.
Quite often I get asked, what should a horse be capable of if you can accurately describe him or her as a well-broke ranch horse? And over the years, I've come to expect certain things of a horse that could be described as basically broke for ranch work. Keep in mind, there are lots of horses at various stages of training, earning their keep every day on working ranches. And to me, every horse is a work in progress. But if the description well-broke ranch horse is used, the horse should be able to do these jobs willingly. Stand still for mounting, move out in a loose rein flat-footed walk, make smooth transitions up and down through all gates from walk to trot, to lope, to gallop and back, straight up in response to light pressure on the reins, go from stop to lope in a couple of strides, or use a term generally applied to English riding, do a canter depart. Drop his nose and flex at the pole in response to gentle pressure on the reins. Do a turn on the forehand in either direction. Do a reasonable roll back in either direction, staying light on his front end. And this is getting important. Show real interest in working cattle. Know how to cut a cow from a herd, holder, or driver. Be able to work quietly in a herd and be responsive in moving a group of cattle. Be willing to help a rider open and close a swinging gate from the saddle from both sides. Be able to handle a situation when the rider needs to rope a full-size cow. Be able to handle the job of heeling calves at a branding. Be able to give you all the speed you need to catch and turn a yearling, and then settle down into a quiet attitude almost immediately after the chase. And, of course, load easily and willingly into a trailer. Now, that's a few of them.
For our good friends at Irvine Saddles and Western Wear, that is the horse training file. Something else that we consider really important in the diet and care of our horses is a daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration. You can find out all about it at hoffmanshorseproducts.com. The way the Canada Revenue Agency deals with ranchers and farmers has changed a lot in the last few years, and the financial decisions we make today can have a long-lasting impact on our bottom line far into the future. It really helps to have a trusted professional who really understands your situation to guide you with all your accounting requirements and your tax preparation. Having an accountant who knows the difference between a Hereford and a heifer, what a slick and backgrounding are, and that Alfalfa and Timothy are not just names from a storybook really helps. Kathy McMillan of PMT Chartered Professional Accountants understands the intricacies of specialized programs like AgriStability and AgriInvest. She understands the demands on your time and can help you spend more time doing your job and less time dealing with endless piles of paperwork. See PMTAccountants.com or call toll-free 877-383-8081. You'll hear more of that conversation I had with the late Harry Prosser after this song, and I think the words came from Magma Winnie, and it's sung here by Bernadette Ducharme.
City kid, belong for those cowboy places where he could smell the scent of pines, taste the freedom of open spaces. And at night he dreamed about horses. Found a nice little spread high up in the hills, and someone who gave him a chance. He proved he was worth every penny he earned and could do anything on the ranch. And he was pretty damn good around horses. He broke every colt that was born on the place, and some that were ranked to the bone. Then he entered the world of the wild ones and branded a few of his own. And he learned all he could about horses. The rodeo scene was exciting and rough, and he got caught up in the game. He rode everything that stood on four legs, but the pony chucks brought him fame. And he always bedded down near his horses. cook is told, and he couldn't ride. He'd help all the gates at the shoes. He wasn't afraid to give some advice and get a little dust on his boots. And he fed and watered the horses. Near the end of his life, he'd sit for hours thinking back to the days of his youth. With failing eyes, he'd stare out the window and wonder how much was the truth. But he was pretty damn sure he saw horses. When he passed on to that range in the sky, nobody would utter a word why he shouldn't be given the honor as wrangler for the heavenly herd. And God knows he was good around horses. Yeah, God knows he was good around horses. Yeah, God knows Frenchie was good around horses.
Well, Harry Prosser's the guy who contacted us about bringing Lucky the Wonder Horse up the Tumbler Ridge for the town's 25th anniversary and opening the show for the RCMP musical ride. And it was an experience that Billy and I, and Lucky, will always remember and treasure, and we were sure inspired by the spirit of that place. And so, at this point, Tumbler Ridge looks like it's got a bright future.
It does. And it's not just because of the oil and the gas and the coal. I truly mean that. It's the people. This town has a spirit that it couldn't be extinguished.
Well, we've certainly experienced that since we've been here, Harry, and thanks for telling us a little bit about what you had to go through, and thank you so much for asking us up here.
It's been my pleasure. I met Hugh and Billy for the first time when they arrived in Tumbler Ridge, and I feel as though I've known them for years.
Well, it's certainly the same for us, Harry, and thanks again.
Coming up on the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, sorting cattle from the perspective of a ranch wife when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Fall Roundup, as I said at the start of the show, is a bittersweet time of the year. Exhilarating and some of the best riding of the season. Clear blue skies, autumn leaves, but the knowledge that the Roundup is about over for another year. My pal Duke Davis wrote a wonderful song that sure captures that feeling. And by the way, Duke is facing some real challenges. He just got out of the hospital in Kerrville, Texas, recently being treated for long-term sepsis and several other serious issues. And his recent words were, "I whipped cancer, and I'm going to whip this demon, too. But y'all might not see me around for a while. Please keep my family in your prayers. This little waltz will probably take a while. God bless you all." Here's Duke.
The sun's waking up in the cowherd, the coffee's beginning to pour. The wrangler has jingled the horses, and old Coosie's been up since four. It's bacon and beans and biscuits, then call out your mount to the boss. It's time for one last big circle on the back of a stout-legged horse. The fall work soon will be over as we gather the last of the herd. The dust devils dance across the prairie, and nobody is saying a word. The far sound of the lowballing cattle makes me tired of being alone. And I feel the first taste of the winter as it chills my soul to the bone. Move along slow to home, boys. Move along slowly for me. Move along, the fall work is over. I'll see you next year in the spring. I'll see you next year in the spring.
cattle, they all move so slowly, fat and lazy this time of year. And we prowl the La Jolla pasture till we rounded up memory last year. We pin and ride back to the wagon, the shipping's all done for the fall. But the blues seem to be all around us, and nobody's riding too tall. Old Paige, now he's fussing with Lolly, but Lolly ain't saying too much. And Lynn, well, he's dreaming of Barbara, and her cheek he's longing to touch. And Jerry, well, he's thinking of his new saddle that he'll pick up when we get to town. While Sam is riding behind us, just dragging and wearing a frown. Move along slow to home, boys. Move along slowly for me. Move along, the fall work is over. I'll see you next year in the spring. I'll see you next year in the spring. Move along slow to home, boys. Move along slowly for me. Move along, the fall work is over. I'll see you next year in the spring. I'll see you next year in the spring. I'll see you next year in the spring.
In the fall gather and subsequent days of preg testing, weaning, and sorting, the fortunate hands are the ones on horseback. And just the other day, we were preg testing over at the neighboring Dalgleish Ranch. I'd ridden over on my good mare, Cody. Everybody else was working on the ground, and AJ said, "Boy, you seem to have a monopoly on this stuff." And I said, "Well, both Cody and I have more seniority here than anybody else." But it was the ranch wife who was on the ground and working the gates, and as always, Melanie just does it right. And on that subject, here's Yvonne Hollenbeck.
I was hosting a Christmas coffee, and I had my house a-looking right. I made the cookies and coffee, but oh boy, I looked a fright. So I was standing in front of the bathroom mirror as a little fluffing up had begun, when my husband burst into the house and hollered, "Could you help me, hon?" They always call you honey when they need help, don't they, though? So I grabbed my coat and my chore boots, and I followed him out through the snow. Now the corrals were full of bawling cows, and their calves was bawling too, and the only way to communicate is to hand signal to the crew. Well, the men, they're all a horseback. I'm afoot. I run the gate, where you have to be real quick to think and never hesitate. You have to know when to open it and let out one or two and close her quick, hook her shut, and don't let the wrong one through. Well, the day had started out real good, but that soon was in the past, because tensions rise when sorting cows and tempers flare real fast. And back to hubby's signals. I will never understand how in this high-tech world we live in, there are no standard signals for the hands. Oh, I know the one for the North Corral, that's where we pin the bulls, and his right arm means the South Corral, that's where we pin the coals. Well, I turned and saw a bunch of cows headed right towards me. Both his arms was fanning in the air, and that's all that I could see. So I opened up the gate real quick, and the cows went running out, and I closed her quick and hooked her shut, and that's when I heard him shout, "Why did you let them cattle out? Gads, woman, don't you know? I signaled for you to turn them back, and you let the whole bunch go." Well, I won't repeat what next was said, but that ended my position. I quit my job of helping him, and I went back to my kitchen. Oh, I did return one signal. It was directed to my loving spouse. I'd sure lost my Christmas spirit when I stomped back to the house. But we cooled down by supper time and our marriage is just fine. But I'm gonna cook a batch of gone this spring when it's sorting time.
Thanks again for making the ride, and I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to Mark and Kathy McMillan, our great support crew. Now be sure to check the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine for all kinds of great reading and pictures, and you can subscribe online at CanadianCowboy.ca. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel for this show and many more from the past with video and lots of videos of the Western Spirit Band and ranching scenes and much more. The links are on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.